and our family. Happy Palm Sunday.
Hi, everybody. I'm Andy. The Grafenauers have been attending FOL for 15 years now.
My name is James. I'm 10 and I'm in fifth grade.
My name is Olivia and I'm 9 and I'm in third grade.
Hi, my name's Amelia. I'm 6 and I'm in fourth grade.
And I'm Kim. You all have probably seen my name on things. We've been involved in a lot of things at FOL over the last 15 years. I currently help out doing administrative stuff in the office. I've been really involved with children's ministry, hospitality a little bit, I think, at some point.
I've served in quite a few roles as well. My favorite and most endearing is setting up chairs every Sunday with all the men as we worship in many different locations across the city. So I am so glad we have our own building. I'm excited to get back there. Hey kiddos, what are some things that you like about FOL or that you've been doing during quarantine?
I'm playing outside more for quarantine.
Yeah, I like playing outside and I like about FOL. I mean, yeah, I like being outside more and spending more time with the family.
My favorite thing is the songs. I like them because I get to dance with my dad.
We do have a little dancer here. And special fun fact, this one right here has a birthday coming up in 2 days. She's gonna be 7, so happy 7th birthday to our Amelia here. And super fun fact, it was 7 years ago this weekend actually that I went into labor at church service with Amelia. I was teaching the preschool class and felt that first contraction, and history told me that labor was going to happen fast, so we quick found we found somebody to cover the class and found somebody to watch the other two, and Andy and I headed down Park Street to the hospital, and Amelia came shooting out, and we probably could have made it back in time for offering. That's how fast she came. So anyway, happy birthday, Amelia. We are excited to worship with you all this morning. It's Fourth Sunday, which means that we have a special children's moment coming up after announcements. So grab the kiddos after announcements, make sure they're here. It's going to be me and my girls actually are going to be leading our children's moment this morning. We also have our another special guest preacher, Reverend Sanetta Ponton. And we are so excited to hear from her. We've been so blessed by some of our guest speakers this month. And there's also going to be a special testimony, so we're excited to hear about that. Before we get started, we want to take a moment to remember those who've been affected by gun violence in our nation over the last couple weeks, particularly families, our Asian American brothers and sisters who are hurting right now because of the violence in Atlanta, and the families who are hurting in Boulder after the shooting there. And we know that there are those of you in our FOL community who have been affected by gun violence as well. And so we hold you all in our hearts, we stand with you, and we are praying for you all. So with that being said, let's get to worshiping.
I know I'm glad that we serve a big God, and there's nothing too hard for him. We can cast our burdens on him, and he'll make them light. So we just thank you, God, for all that you are to each and every one of us. There's nobody like you. Hallelujah. We serve a big God, yeah.
Strong.
goes beyond my wildest dreams. Oh, I thank you, God. You're so big, God. You're so big, God. There's nothing you cannot do, God. Hallelujah. There's nothing too hard for you, Lord. Hallelujah. You're a big God. You're a big God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, my God is big, so strong, so mighty, yes, my God, your plans for me, oh, goes beyond my wildest dreams. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Morning, FOL, and happy Sunday. I'm Chris Handrick, and I get the honor of walking us through our morning announcements. Next Sunday, Easter Sunday, April 4th, we're having a resurrection service at 10 a.m. Something special is we're going to be in person out in our parking lot together. This does take a little bit more planning, so we're asking that you please prepare ahead and come between 9:30 and 9:45 a.m. so that we can get everyone parked and settled in for us to have a great experience together. Due to the timing of this, our public reading of Scripture is being moved from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. If you have questions, please reach out to Pastor Tyler. We're putting together Easter goodie bags for the kids, but we need help. If you're able to volunteer to help stuff these bags, please reach out to Rachel Compton Allen at rca@nehemiah.org. We're looking to distribute these at the Resurrection Service and the Thursday before at the Food Pantry. We're putting together Easter food baskets, and all of these will include a ham. These are going to be available for pickup this Thursday, April 1st at 11 a.m. during the normal food pantry hours. If you're interested in one of these baskets, please register at bit.ly/Easter food basket. If you need to set up a different time or a delivery of this basket, please reach out to Sister Jackie Hunt. Speaking of our food pantry, we want to remind you that on the first Thursday and third Tuesday of every month, we offer a food and personal essentials pantry. This is right in our FOL parking lot, and the dates for this month are the 1st and the 20th. A reminder that this comes on a first-come, first-served basis, and if an FOL attender needs a different time to be able to get access to these items, please reach out to Sister Jackie. We do need volunteers from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. on the distribution days, if you're willing and able. We're having a Good Friday service that's being put on by the African American Council of Churches. This service, entitled Seven Last Words of Christ, will feature seven Black pastors and will stream on Mount Zion's Facebook page and YouTube channel. This is happening this Friday at 6:30 p.m. That's this Friday, 6:30 p.m. Wednesday is the last day to donate for the Delta Sigma Theta School Supply Drive. They partner with a school in Ghana. They're specifically looking for pens, pencils, erasers, backpacks, soap, and toothpaste. If you'd like to donate, please email madisondstinternational@gmail.com. This month, we've had many guest preachers. In honor of Women's History Month, we've been hearing from many women pastors from around the country. Today, we're going to be hearing from Reverend Sanetta Ponton, pastor of Justice, Advocacy, and Compassion at Metro Community Church and the director of Metro Community Center in New Jersey. She loves God and God's people and has a heart for sharing God's message with about love and justice. We're thrilled to be able to have her with us in our service today. In light of recent events and increased violence and racism that's been witnessed by our Asian and Asian American community, we want to affirm that we stand in solidarity. Racism, hate, and violence of any God's image bearers is unacceptable. We've put together resources on our website and in the e-bulletin If you go to the resources tab, you can see a talk from Pastor Alex and his Korean American friend, Pastor Peter Han, a PBS documentary, and a link to the Asian American Christian Collaborative. Please check these out and let others in our community know that these resources are available to them. A special announcement. We all know Sister Jackie Hunt, and we know how much she pours into our community at FOL and outside our walls. She's a faithful servant of God and a tireless advocate for the marginalized in our community. And she's got a big milestone birthday tomorrow. She's turning 60 on March 29th, and we're excited and want to celebrate. In honor of her birthday, she's seeking donations in denomination of 6 and 0 to support Foster's new initiative called the House of Mary Experience, or HOME. Please prayerfully consider making donations, again, with 6 and 0 in mind. $6, $60, $600, $6,000, whatever you're able to do to support her work with Foster. Donations can be made directly in the Cash App at Foster Inc. or through the FOL giving platform and select Foster. We have many regular happenings around FOL every week, from Bible studies to scripture readings to youth ministries to dance ministries. And if you want to get further involved, we ask that you lean in. Please check out our website or the bulletin to learn more information. You can also reach out to our office for more questions. We're now going to enter a time of giving, and we ask that you lean in. We are so, so thankful for our faithful financial partners, for our FOL ministries within our church, but then also where we extend out of our walls in our community. We ask that you consider financially supporting and partnering with us as we continue to want to be a church that's part of our community. Thank you, and enjoy Sunday.
That we're talking about is about Jesus.
So, and they didn't have candy, so instead they flew palms.
These are things they cut off of trees. And why did they have a parade? Well, I just told you, Jesus Christ. You know who Jesus is? He's the Son of God. But you know who Jesus Christ is? Yes, he's also the Son of God.
Well,
and Christ is not your last name like you and me, right, Millie?
Yeah. But what is a Christ is it means Jesus is the chosen one.
He was chosen by God to be our Savior. So, the Jewish people, or people that celebrate God, made a big parade for Jesus with palms and people, and everybody was happy.
And, you know, that reminds me of prayers and everything. So, Millie, would you like to lead us in the Lord's Prayer?
You know the Lord's Prayer, please sing along with us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom comes, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory,
forever and ever.
Amen. That was the Lord's Prayer, everybody. Thanks for joining us for Palm Sunday.
And bye-bye.
Bye.
Morning, Fountain of Life. This is Pastor Tyler stopping in quickly to share a little bit about what's coming up next in service. So as you've probably noticed on Fourth Sundays, we often have a form of testimony happen in our service. We've been doing this for a few months now, and this Sunday is no different. And so this Sunday we're going to be having a testimony shared by our own brother Henry Lucy Lee. And today's testimony is something that we find really important for us to lean in and listen to, especially in this moment where within our nation, hate and racism against Asian Americans has been on the uptick since the beginning of COVID-19, as well as we've had the recent murders in Atlanta. And we know that this is not new history. We know that this is history that has been formed in the United States for a very long time. And since the beginning of our nation, we've displayed this. And so we want to take a few moments. Brother Henry actually recorded this last year, and we shared it in August, but we wanted to share it again. And so we really encourage you to lean in, to listen in, to hear his story, to hear and engage with, and let your heart be open to how he shares about his own experience in his life and for us to learn. Also encourage you to engage with the resources he shares at the end to learn more about Asian American experience in America. Just lean in at this time. I know my heart has been so heavily affected by what's been happening. My heart goes out, and the thing about what I'm looking at is I'm looking at the fact that it's another white male Christian who claims to serve the Jesus that I serve, yet goes out and does acts like this. And so I have to identify with how this is happening on my watch, how people and individuals that look like me continue to allow this to happen. And so I'm gonna be leaning in hard as I'm listening to Minister Henry here. I think it's important for me to learn and to continue to grow and look at this and to know I have so much work left to do. That healing in this nation, that Jesus is there with us and alongside us, but we have a long ways to continue to go. We know that in our congregation, we know that in our context. And we're leaning in. So I'm gonna share a few other resources that we're gonna have available on the website this week. And so there's a few different ones. There is a statement that we can all sign if we would like, put on by the Asian American Collaborative Network and Christian Collaborative Network. And they have a statement coming out as a result of the murders in Atlanta. And so if you would like to sign it, we'll have a link to how you can sign that there. And they just have a ton of resources on their website as well if you'd like to engage with that. And we also have the PBS documentary that Mr. Henry will mention as well that we'll have a link to. You'll be able to watch and learn a lot from there. I encourage you to lean in and listen. And I'm so excited to hear this testimony and story shared by our own brother, Henry Lucy Lee.
Good morning, FOL. My name is Henry Lucy Lee. Una, my wife, and I have been attending FOL since we moved to Madison from Chicago a little over 6 years ago. Today, I'm here to share with you my immigration story and how it's tied to the civil rights and Black Lives Matter movement today. In a short history of Asian in America, more than 60 years ago, the civil rights movement led by the African American and many others to fight for equal rights, their impact far more than just the United States. It has a global impact. Originally, a fight for the right to vote, but we all know it was for the dignity of all people. One of the key results of the civil rights movement was 1965 Immigration Act, where United States will no longer favor only immigrants from the Northern European countries, not just the white folks anymore. My family and many non-European immigrants were able to come to the United States because the struggle of the African-American community that resulted the 1965 Immigration Act. Like I said, not just for the United States, but a global impact. All of us, a non-European, non-white folks that came to the United States after 1965, were here because the people who fought for the Civil Rights Movement, the same African-American community that fought for their rights to be heard, to have one vote for one person, is still fighting today. And that is the Black Lives Matter. I stand and support the Black Lives Matter movement because without them, without this community, I could not be here. And you should too. Now back to this Asian in America. Now the Asian have been coming to the United States in three different waves. I just talked to you about the third wave because through the 1965 Immigration Act. The second wave, many Asian was brought here to build a railroad from the West. It was more of come, finish the railroad, and then go home. There's no visa, there was no rights to own property or able to vote. It was well known that it was the Irish who built the railroad from the East Coast, and it was the Chinese that built the railroad from the West Coast, and the railroad finally met in St. Louis. In the famous photo where the two trains met in St. Louis, the Chinese were told, don't show up for the photo. They wrote us out of the history. Now, who were the first wave of people? When did they come? Well, they came right after the Civil War because the plantation owner knows that they very soon the black slave will have to leave their plantation. They still need people to come and pick cottons. So the Chinese and Filipino men were bought in to replace the black slaves. They couldn't call them slaves. They called them indenture servants. And we know that trick, right? It's just the same trick, different name. Now, many people have asked me, the immigrant come and took over other people's job. Well, let me tell you about my immigration story and let you make up your mind. I was born in Taiwan. My whole family immigrated to the United States November 22nd, 1977. I was 10 years old. Our first home was in Southside Chicago, 114th Street and Michigan Avenue, the Roseland Park neighborhood. My sister and brother and I were the only Asian in the whole Curtis Elementary School. In fact, we were the lightest skinned folk in the whole entire school. Our family owned and operated a medical center to serve the underserved area of neighborhood of Roseland community. The medical center has a dental clinic, 5 family doctors, all Asian American, and a pharmacy. The nearest hospital was in the Beverly neighborhood, about 12 miles away, on the other side of Dan Ryan. For all of you who are non-Chicagoan, Dan Ryan is I-94 in the near south side of Chicago. That's the highway. So Roseland on one side, Beverly on the other side. If you need to fill your prescription, you will need to ride CTA bus, take one transfer, and that will take you 2 hours to get to the hospital in Beverly, and then 2 hours back. Our pharmacy in the Roseland Park from 1970 to 1985 was the only pharmacy operating in that neighborhood. Let me tell you more about our family, other family who came to the United States and their job, and let you make up your mind if we took over people's position. My uncle Josh is a pastor, graduate from North Park College, and he and our family owned a medical center. My uncle Arthur was one of the scientists from Ohio State Research Department that created the first contraceptive injection that allowed women to have an injection once a year instead of taking pills. My parents owned mixed income apartment buildings to serve in the neighborhood in Chicago, like Uptown, Rogers Park, and Roseland Park. One of the apartments we own, it's an old hotel converted into a apartment complex to accommodate short-term housing for people coming out of jail, restaurant workers who cannot afford a housing or down payment for their rent, and for first-generation college students who can't afford the price of a dorm on campus. That's a little bit about our family. Today, I'm an artist, also a campus minister. I'm not quite sure I took over someone's job. So if you have more questions about Asian and well, my immigration story or Asian America, I would love to talk to you more about it. But for yourself, if you want to learn more about Asian in America, there's a new PBS series that just came out last spring, 3-part series called Asian Americans. So I will have somebody connect a link somewhere for you to find it. Thank you for listening. Appreciate it.
Chasing after you, give my life to you, to be more like you. I'm running from the things that hold me back, free from the past. Storms aren't meant to last, no. Farther than I've ever gone, draw me close to you, close to you, Lord, closer than I've ever been, farther than I've ever gone. Said it'd be easy trying to live for Christ. He died for a price so we could have new life. I know it gets hard sometimes trying to walk in the faith, using the grace that he gave you to show the world you've been made new. Oh, keep running, keep moving. Fasting, keep praying, and he'll help you to draw you close to him, close to him, closer than you've ever been, and farther than you'll ever go. Oh, close to you, close. closer than you've ever been, farther than you'll ever go. Draw me close, draw me close. Gotta be where you are. I draw near to you, you draw near to me. I love your presence. I draw near to you, you draw near to me. I love your presence. Oh, so draw me close to you, close to you. Closer than I've ever been. Take me farther than I've ever gone. Draw me close, draw me close, draw me, ooh, my. Closer than I've ever been. Oh,
hey, Found of Life, good morning. If you're like me, you have been tremendously blessed this month by the powerful word that been delivered to us by these great preachers, Pastor Becca Bowling, Reverend Laleda, Reverend Brenda Salter McNeil from Quest Church in Seattle. And today you're gonna hear a powerful word from Reverend Sanetta Patton. She's an associate pastor at my buddy's church, Metro Community Church, where Pastor Peter Ahn is the senior pastor. They're working on a community center in Englewood, and she is the executive director of that. She did her undergraduate at Columbia. She did her law degree at Harvard. She did her M.Div, her theological studies at Duke. And it's just this brilliant theologian, powerful preacher, has great insight. And I just thought that it would be just so much of a blessing to us for us to hear the word of God from her. So please, ready your hearts, open your minds, and just get ready for this great message in the ministry of Pastor Sanetta Patton. You're going to be blessed today.
Thank you to Pastor Alex G. and the Fountain of Life Covenant Church family for allowing me to share with you this morning. And I also want to thank my pastor, Pastor Peter Ahn, and I'm grateful for the friendship that he and your pastor have developed over the years. If you would join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time together to share your word. And God, we thank you that distance doesn't mean anything in this season of technology that allows us to be in totally different places, but to experience your word together. So God, I have prayed and prepared as best I know how, but Lord, we pray that you would preach this message. I have studied your scripture, Lord, and studied your word, but you must send your Holy Spirit. And I have written words on paper, but I pray, God, that you would write them on our hearts, that we would be encouraged even in the rocky times of our lives. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. And all of God's children, wherever you are, join me in saying amen. Today, I want to share with you from John chapter 19, verses 25 through 27. I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version, John chapter 19, verses 25 through 27. And it reads as follows. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. Now, if you would bear with me for just a moment, there is actually a title for this sermon, which rarely happens for me. The title is Rocky Road is Not Just Ice Cream. And if you just bear with me, I promise you I'm going somewhere with it. When I think of ice cream, I think of fun and happiness and excitement. I think of those hot summer days and that cold, refreshing ice cream. I can't wait for summer to come. I think of Ben and Jerry's or Baskin Robbins, that cold, refreshing sweetness. You temporarily suspend your diet and your healthy eating just for a moment to indulge. After all, you need the calcium, right? Ice cream is good and it's full of great memories. Remember being a little kid and having a scoop of ice cream and you're licking it and then all of a sudden it just sort of tumbles on the ground and you just stand there for a second wondering, could you actually eat it? Or maybe as a teenager, you went with that boy or that girl that you liked to get a scoop of ice cream. Now as an adult, you may indulge in the good kind of ice cream, the Häagen-Dazs or the Cold Stone Creamery, or my personal favorite now, Talenti. Oh my goodness. And now you've probably moved beyond the vanilla or the chocolate to more sophisticated flavors, maybe a butter pecan or dulce de leche, chocolate chip cookie dough, or even Rocky Road. Now you indulge in those ingredients that change the texture of the ice cream, the nuts or the caramel pieces, the fruit and the marshmallows. These ingredients add depth to the creaminess and layers of flavor on your tongue's palate. Consider the Rocky Road ice cream. With its chocolate or vanilla base, the added pecans and marshmallows. We get a bit of joy as we savor the chocolate or vanilla, but delight in that contrast of the crunchy and the salty pecans with the soft gooiness of marshmallows. But sometimes Rocky Road ice cream is not as delightful. Sometimes the nuts can crack your teeth. Sometimes the lactose causes you discomfort. Sometimes the marshmallows can get stuck in a cavity. And it's in those times that we stop and we think and we realize that there's more to Rocky Road. Rocky Road is not just ice cream, it's a metaphor for life. It's a sober reminder that life is not always as sweet as ice cream. It's not as simple as dishing out another scoop if yours has fallen to the ground. Life isn't always easy. There are some challenges and there are some losses. There's heartache. Blessings can sometimes feel like curses. Curveballs can seem to be flying right at you all the time. There are times when you've had to fight for your life or for your sanity or for someone else. As poet Langston Hughes would say, life ain't been no crystal stair. It's had tacks in it and splinters and boards torn up. We have come to know in living this life's journey that life can be rocky. That Rocky Road is not just ice cream. And isn't that why so many of us tune into church? Something is going on in our lives and we just can't handle it. Life does not always feel good. There's pain and heartache in the world on a normal day, and now we add COVID on top of it all. There's grief and sadness because the reality is that we all have to deal with pain. We all experience suffering in some ways in this life, but why and how? These are the tough questions. But we wrestle with them because when we take the time to wrestle with God and ask the questions of God, we experience God in a new and deeper way. So we ask ourselves, what do we do with suffering in this world? What do we make of the rocky parts of our lives? And we're not the only ones. As we meet Mary at the cross in this text this morning, she's looking back on her life, and I imagine she's thinking about the rocky road she's been through. It's been a rough journey from the beginning. And with our imaginations, I believe she begins to recall the rocky road that she's lived. Mary had had some deep, deep valleys in her life. It started almost from the beginning. Yes, she had willingly and obediently agreed to give birth to the Son of God. That was almost the easy part. Now she had to be pregnant for 9 months. This blessing most certainly began to feel like a curse pretty early on. Joseph would have broken off her engagement if the angel hadn't spoken with him. But what about her family? Can you imagine going to your mother and telling her that this pregnancy is the work of the Holy Spirit? And what about everyone else? No doubt there were snickers and gossip. People saw her condition and probably assumed that she was immoral or crazy. An angel said what? The Holy Spirit did what? Mary endured shame and ridicule, the misunderstanding and the assumptions. Even now, we demonize unwed mothers. We let the men go off scot-free, but call the women all kinds of names that I will dare not say from the pulpit. We forget that every cruel word, every accusation, every side eye we give to a woman or a girl in the name of Jesus and holiness actually pushes them further and further from Jesus. Rocky Road is not just ice cream. But Mary makes it through her pregnancy. Joseph stands by her and marries her. She is legitimized and the shame is gone. But she is carrying the Son of God, the promised Messiah, the one who will reign on David's throne forever. Surely, she thought, there'd be somewhere safe, maybe even clean, to give birth to her baby. But no. Her beloved firstborn child would be born in a manger among animals. You know the story. And if that wasn't bad enough, there was a hit out on her baby boy from the very beginning. She lived in survival mode and tried to keep her baby safe so that he could grow up and save Israel, that he could actually save the world. She must have thought, this is a pretty rocky road ahead of me. And it continued, this rocky life, filled with its highs and its lows. She loses Jesus at 12 years old during an annual trip to Jerusalem for Passover. She witnesses him turn water into wine. She hears about her son healing the sick and feeding the multitudes. These very same miracles will cause the Pharisees to want him killed. She didn't always understand him. The multitudes didn't always understand him. We don't know all the details, but we know that it wasn't good all the time. Have you ever felt like Mary? That rocky road is not just ice cream? That your life hasn't always been easy? Some may have even thought you were crazy. And yes, maybe you didn't always do the right thing. Maybe you were out on the streets. Maybe you were the one who slept around. Maybe your heart was cold, but that was before Christ. That was BC. But the shame and the ridicule is still there, the glances and maybe even the whispers. You've transformed now, but maybe people, or even you yourself, are long on memories and short on grace. Maybe you're just trying to do what the Lord called you to do, but no one else has your calling and no one else has your walk, and so they don't understand what God is trying to do in your life. They can't believe what the Holy Spirit is doing because they've never seen it before, even though God always promises that he's going to do a new thing. So they talk and they whisper. They say, that's not God. Rocky Road is not just ice cream. Or you think you finally made it through the storm, only to be shaken by a earthquake. You finally get yourself together, and now, after all you've been through, you find yourself homeless, or jobless, or friendless, or spouseless. You're in survival mode. You are just finding your footing, and here comes COVID. Or stay-at-home orders have exposed some cracks in your marriage, or maybe your parenting, or even your character. Watching the numbers go up and down. Is school in person this week or virtual? If it's not one thing, it's another. Rocky Road is not just ice cream, and maybe it's not you personally what's going on in your own life, but maybe you carry the weight of the world on your heart. Our nation is trying to recover from an insurrection at the Capitol. Parents are crying out for missing children. The water in Flint, Michigan is still unsafe. Mass incarceration of mostly black and brown bodies, lead paint in public housing, suicides and mental health issues on the rise, the opioid crisis. Lord, would you have mercy on your world? You can't even turn on the TV anymore. You can't go to Facebook or Instagram or Twitter. Don't even answer your phone, because Rocky Road, you know, is not just ice cream. I believe Mary, as she stands at the cross, is thinking about the Rocky Road life she has had. This moment by far is the rockiest of them all. Mary's mind, I believe, is capturing images. She can hardly absorb it all. Her son has been wrongly accused and arrested. The very same people among whom he healed and fed and taught are now calling for his crucifixion. He carries the cross up Golgotha. He is crucified between two thieves. He is nailed to a cross. Soldiers are fighting over his clothes. Her son is hanging before her. She's crying as she looks up at her son, as it's displayed in mockery, King of the Jews. His enemies claim it's blasphemy, but she knows that it's true. His body is hanging just a few feet from her face. She could probably reach out to him. I imagine her tears creating pools of mud underneath the dirt at her feet. She smells the putrid scent of her son's blood mixed with sweat. She remembers that smell from his birth. She hears the mocking and the laughter behind her mixed with the wails of her sisters and her friends. She looks up at her son. This woman's work, this mother's burden. My God, a parent is not supposed to bury their child. And he was to be the savior of the world. She didn't think it was going to be like this. Rocky Road is more than just ice cream. As she stands at the cross, she joins the line of mothers who have wailed over their children gone too soon. Eve would look down at Abel, slain by his brother, her other son. Rizpah would stand guard over the dead bodies of her hanged sons to protect them from the vultures. Bathsheba would hold her precious baby, the product of the sin of adultery she was forced to commit. And now Mary, standing witness to her son's death. Oh, so many mothers. The mothers watching their sons hang from trees bearing strange fruit. The mother of Emmett Till, the mother of Trayvon Martin, the mothers of Freddie Gray and Eric Garner and Philando Castile, Sandra Bland and Breonna Taylor, George Floyd calling out for his mother. We could be here all day. Why can't Rocky Road just be ice cream? And yet, Mary is blessed. Mary is blessed beyond measure. Mary was the epitome of one favored by God. We know from the beginning that there was something about Mary that marked her purity even more so than her virginity. Of course, she was a sinner like the rest of us, but she loved God and wanted to do his will. Here am I, servant of the Lord, let it be with me according to your will, she says. She may not have known her calling right away, but on the day the angel visits her, there was no doubt that she had been called, anointed, and chosen by God. She was handpicked by God to birth and raise his only begotten son. And the truth is that we're all blessed. We are all saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that God proves his love for us and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That God would send his only begotten son to die for a group of sinners who may or may not ever acknowledge him is the greatest blessing we could ever receive. To those who would believe in him, he gave the power to become children of God. We have victory over sin, victory over death, and victory over hell. And one day we're going to be with the Lord forever. And he could have stopped there, and that honestly would have been enough. But then he pours out even more of his grace and his mercy upon us, promising us an abundant life here on earth. He gives us his constant presence, promising us that he will never leave us nor forsake us. He gives us comfort, reminding us, come to me, all that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. He gives us strength when we are weak. And he does more. He wakes us up every morning. And in my old church, we used to say, clothed and in our right minds. He gives us food to eat, a warm place to live, the faculty of our limbs, friends and family and jobs. And as the word says, my God will satisfy all your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Wherever you are, you can praise God because he keeps blessing you. But our blessedness and calling doesn't mean that we're shielded from hardship. Quite the opposite. Jesus promised us in the world we will have tribulations. We've got to be prepared for it, and we've got to be careful how we talk about blessedness so that we don't continue believing that any hardship, any rocky road is a sign of God's disfavor. God never promised you that you would have a mansion here on earth. He didn't say that you would never be sick. He didn't say that you would never have financial trouble. He never said you wouldn't be like Paul with the thorn in your side. What he said was, my grace is sufficient. He said, is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor gather into barns, and your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Now, if God chooses to bless you with financial resources, God bless you. But you are not less blessed. You are not less favored. You are not less loved if you're living paycheck to paycheck or praying for a paycheck. God will bless you how he determines to bless you. We burden people with this narrow view of God and God's blessings. Mary was poor and lowly, and she was blessed and favored by God. We've got to be careful how we talk about blessedness. God is not a quid pro quo God, a something for something God. We do not praise God in order to get blessings. We praise God because God is God, and he's holy, and he's sovereign, and he's mighty, and he's powerful, and he's loving and forgiving and gracious, and he's worthy to be praised. Whether you're in a mansion or a shelter, God is still God, and God is still good, and his steadfast love still continues to endure forever. Don't confuse God with things. And don't confuse a blessed life with a problem-free life, because it damages people. Hardship becomes seen as God's disfavor. But people of God, we have to be honest with ourselves and with others. You're going to cry sometimes. It's going to be hard sometimes. It is the nature of a fallen and sinful world. Rocky road is not just ice cream. And rocky roads can happen for any number of reasons. Sometimes it is because of sin. When David slept with Bathsheba and had Uriah killed, God punished David with the death of his and Bathsheba's firstborn child. David had sinned against the Lord and opened up the occasion for the enemies of God to blaspheme. And so God was punished. And so David was punished. But Job hadn't done anything wrong. He lost his fortune, his servants, his children, and his health. And it wasn't because he sinned or displeased God. That is what his friends thought. But God said, there is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. And God was right, because in all of the loss, Job never cursed God. In fact, he said, shall we receive the good at the hands of God and not receive the bad? Job's was a mature faith that understood that God makes the sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. It's going to happen. Suffering will come. Hardships will come. But how will you respond? How will you respond when life gets rocky? First, you need to have people around you who can help you pray through it. You need to have praying people around you. Mary found herself in the most difficult and heart-wrenching moment of her life. Her son was dying the most excruciating, shameful death right before her eyes. Mary wasn't alone. There were tons of people around her. There were soldiers, but they were fighting over his clothes. There were other onlookers, the centurion and other mockers. There were people all around Mary, but Mary didn't need just any kind of people. She needed particular types of people. She needed her girls. She needed those three sisters around her, with her, mourning not only for themselves because they too believed in Jesus, but also for her because her pain was deeper. She had nursed him, and she had cleaned his cuts, and she had watched him grow up and sent him out into the world, and now she was losing him. She needed the right people around her. When you're going through something, and I mean really going through something, you can't isolate yourself. You need to have people around you who are going to encourage you and journey with you and force you, if they have to stay the course. You need people who can pray and intercede for you and fast for you, who will cry out for you, who will be your Aaron and your Hur, who will hold up your arms until the war is over. You need people who will subject themselves to pain and discomfort to sit with you in your pain and your discomfort. People who will hug you hard enough and long enough to absorb some of the pain for themselves. You need people of faith who will stare down cancer, who will stare down the judge, who will stare down the spouse or the child, whatever it is, and declare that God is able to do anything but fail. You don't need a lot. You just need the right people around you when the road gets rocky. Do you have those people in your life? Better yet, are you the type of person that can be with someone in the rocky roads of their life? Second, you also need to be in the right position. You need to be in the right position. Mary knew where she needed to be. She needed to be at the foot of the cross. When hardships happen in our lives, we cannot abandon Jesus. Some of us will want to pull away. We'll want to give up because we have deduced that God would not allow this pain to enter into our lives. So you'll want to turn away, but you can't. Your comfort is found at the cross. Jesus is at the cross. Look at the text. Jesus is on the cross. Go to the cross. This is the site of his own pain and at the same time the greatest display of his self-giving and love for us. This is the height of evil and the depth of the goodness of God all at the same time. His divine generosity has reached its peak. Even his clothes have been taken away from him, and yet he looks down at his mother and he sees her specific pain. Someone needs to hear that this morning, that in all that's going on in the world, God still sees you and your specific pain. God sees your pain. He sees your grief. He sees your heartache. He sees your marriage. He sees your bills. He sees your health challenges. He sees your unemployment. He sees your shame. Just as he saw Hagar in the wilderness and Naomi's despairing heart and Hannah's shame and Mary's grief, he sees you and he will intervene. Even as Jesus is literally pouring out his life to save his mother, he goes even further to meet her specific need. Jesus is still caring. He's still providing. Jesus speaks to her. When we are going through these rocky moments of our lives, we've got to get to the cross and listen for the voice of God. God will speak to us on our knees in prayer. He will speak to us through his word. He will speak to us when we press our way into his presence. Because when we get to the cross, when we listen for God's voice, there we will find our comfort. There we will find our peace. Don't give up praying. Get to the cross. Don't give up worshiping. Get to the cross. And finally, we need to trust God's way of handling the situation. When life gets rocky, we need to trust God's way of handling the situation. Now, sometimes God will fix the situation according to our human notions. Your son will get sober. You will find another job. That person will be healed. Mary, in her finite mind, may have wanted Jesus' life to be spared. She prayed, I'm sure, that there could be another way that humanity would be saved. But that was not God's plan, and that was not the best plan. Under Mary's plan, her son would have lived, and she would have still been in her sin, suffering under the penalty of death and hell. But under God's masterful plan, she is saved by grace. Jesus wasn't just dying for us. He was dying to save his mother too. We have to trust God's plan for working all things out for our good, for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. And yes, sometimes it will be hard. But this is where we have to stop playing church. This is where we have to stop just talking about our faith and living out our faith. This is where we put our money where our mouth is, where we walk the walk and where we talk the talk. This is where we would declare, like Job, even with tears pouring down our eyes, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. This is where we ask God to give us divine understanding of his plan. This is where we walk by faith and not by sight. This is where we say, I've got my mind made up and I'm not turning back. You see, even though the plan may not have been what we wanted, God does not leave us empty-handed with no plan at all. Jesus does not leave Mary without any comfort or without any peace. And he doesn't leave us either. Jesus looks down at his grieving mother with tears rolling down her face, her pain and her agony, even as he faced his own, and he meets her need. He takes care of her. He says, woman, here is your son. And then he says to the disciple whom he loved, here is your mother. And we are told that the disciple took Mary into his home from that very hour. He knew his mother would need a place to deposit all of her maternal love and wisdom. She would need someone to protect her, someone to cover her. Tradition suggests that Joseph may have died at some point prior to this. And so Mary would have needed to be provided for. He gives her a son. And to the disciple, he entrusts him with his mother. That makes me happy because Mary did not have to say a word. She just had to be there, and Jesus saw her. He knew her need, and he fulfilled it. And he's done it for me, and I know he'll do it for you. My mother died when I was 21, and I remember thinking that I would not make it. When I think of the pain of people like Bobby Christina, Whitney Houston's daughter, who endured publicly so much and mourned the death of her mother, she succumbed to drugs, was in a coma, and ultimately died. My heart goes out to her because I think that that could have been me. But I thank God that he raised up women around me who mothered me. They encouraged me. They pray for me. They offer me godly advice. They cook for me, and they love me. I know God will provide and heal and comfort. He has done it for me, and I know he will do it for you. God will fix our situations in his way and in his time. And that's the blessing, because the truth is, Rocky Road is not just ice cream. It actually has a purpose. The Rocky Road ice cream flavor was created in 1929 by William Dreyer and his partner, Joseph Eady. Well, after the Wall Street crash of 1929, Dreyer and Eady gave this chocolate walnut marshmallow creation the name Rocky Road with the purpose of, quote, giving folks something to smile about in the midst of a Great Depression. Did you catch that? Rocky Road was not just something to satisfy the sweet tooth, but to give people a sense of hope. In the midst of unemployment and poverty and hunger and despair, hope in the midst of a Great Depression. Do you see that? The purpose of the Rocky Road is to give us hope. And I promise you, it's not just an ice cream sermon, a slogan. It's actually Bible. Romans 5 says, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us. The ultimate purpose of suffering, the ultimate purpose of the Rocky Road, is to produce hope. Hope is still pushing its way out. When Mary was knee-deep in Rocky Road, when Mary was in the midst of her deepest and greatest depression, there was nothing but hope all around her. Hope was on the cross looking down at her. Woman, here is your son. Just as Jesus was hanging on the cross, just as Jesus was pouring out his blood, just as he was dying the most painful, humiliating, undeserved death, he was doing it for her. And he was doing it for me, and he was doing it for you so that we could have hope. The son that she once gave life to was giving her eternal life. The son whom she was afraid to lose would now never leave her nor forsake her. The son whom she raised would be raised on the third day. There is hope in the midst of any great depression, of any situation, because God does not leave us hopeless. He doesn't leave us helpless. Even when we are facing the most difficult of trials, God shows up with hope. Someone offers you a meal when you're down to your last dollar. That is hope. Your grandchild calls you and offers you an opportunity to see them on FaceTime. That's hope. A funny memory runs through your head as you're grieving the loss of a spouse and you laugh. That is hope. The scripture that you needed to hear today or last week or maybe tomorrow that keeps you from letting go and gives you peace, that's hope. The word of God still comes to us, even virtually, though the church doors are closed. That's hope. God promises never to leave us nor forsake us. That's hope. God promises to supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. That's hope. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. That is hope. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm. That is hope. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. That is hope. For our God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask or imagine. That is hope. Fountain of Life, I encourage you to stay connected to the source of hope. Don't let despair get you down. Don't let the rocky moments in our lives cause you to lose hope. Hold on to the hope we have in Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I thank you that even as life gets rocky, as even though the road gets rough sometimes, that you always leave us with hope. God, I thank you that just as you saw the needs of Mary, you see our needs. And so whatever needs are burdening the heart of any man, woman, or child who is hearing this word, God, I pray that you would remind them that you see their specific pain, and that you will show up and give them hope. God, I pray that they stay close to the cross. And God, I pray that you raise up men and women to come alongside each other in the rocky storms and the rocky portions of our life. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
We're back, and we hope you enjoyed service.
Thank you again to Reverend Sanetta for preaching the word to us this morning. I don't know about you all, but I have been touched so much by our guest preachers over the last couple weeks. I am taking their messages to heart, and I hope you are too. Livy's going to close us out in prayer.
We are glad that God let us worship, even though we're during a pandemic and COVID-19. I hope you are all blessed and learning things, even though we are in COVID-19. Amen. We'll see you next week in the parking lot for Resurrection Sunday.
And lastly,
we enter to worship and exit to serve.
Bye.